Greetings all, welcome back here to another session of Toosie Talks. And today we're going to continue our discussion in language assessment in the ESL curriculum. In particular today, we're going to be looking at assessing listening. Just to let you know, the majority of this information is going to be coming from Brown and Pina-Nevada's text, A Language Assessment Principles in the Classroom. So right over there, you may want to take a peek at it and maybe even purchase it. All right, let's jump in here and look at some of the things that are important for assessing listening. It's actually one of the first questions we're going to ask about why is it important to do that. We'll also look at some more of the different types of listening, intensive listening, responsive listening, extensive listening, and then selective listening. All right, why should we be doing assessment of listening at all? For some people, I would think there's very little need for them to do assessing of listening because they're very good listeners. Because they notice things. They notice when people are speaking a certain way. And for them, it's interesting, and they can pick up the difference between what they're saying, what other people are saying, and it's less important for them. For others, they cannot notice the difference, or they cannot figure out how to produce the difference in their mouth, in their head. And so it's going to be important for them. Again, the process of evaluating this listening skill is going to be difficult because you cannot observe the actual process of listening. You can't observe the process or the product. You have to observe it through some other skill. Okay, you have to observe what they know, what they can actually hear through some other skills. So that's one reason why this is a more difficult element to assess. But one reason why we should do it is to increase their noticing abilities. You know, in addition to teaching ESL students or teaching teachers about how to teach language, a great class to teach native speakers or second language learners is a course in phonology. And while you're teaching them phonology, you're trying to teach them all of the articulation points and the manners of articulation. And they're amazed at the sounds that they are missing. I have students come back, you know, later in the middle of a course, and they'll tell me, you know, now they're addicted to this whole nature of listening to how people enunciate their words, whether they're saying it trippingly on the tongue or whether they're just kind of fluffing everything together and just kind of running together everything. They learn how to be more perceptive in this, and so it's good for second language learners also to practice their listening so they can notice these differences. Not only in themselves, but also in others. Also increases their metacognitive skills, their ability to think about thinking, to think about language. And so that's going to help them notice more as well. Now, as I said, it can't be done in isolation. So in one sense, it's a little harder to assess. A little harder to assess because you got to use other stuff to do that. Can they hear? Well, I can just raise your hand if that's the case. But they've got to be able to understand what's going on, right? So again, it's difficult to do. Some will even ask, why assess it at all? And I would think for some people who have a good ear, and the second language that they're learning is not far phonologically from the language they're using, okay, maybe not. But for many people, especially certain sounds, it would be a benefit to them to notice. So, enough of why it's important. A couple of things that you can be studying. You can study and investigate micro skills, and you can do macro. Kind of a simple breakdown here. Your micro skills are your very small sound segments. The sound discriminations between, two different letters, or a word chunk, or classes of a word, or the way that you can focus on stress. In English. So, I mean, the example that I often use with my students is the word import, I-M-P-O-R-T. Well, if I emphasize the first one, import, that's going to be one word. But import, I'm stressing the second one now, is a different word. You could be talking about those things. You can talk about reduced forms, which we use all the time in English. I am going to is reduced down to I'm gonna. Sound-wise, it's a reduced form. You can talk about cohesive devices, and obviously you can talk about the meaning of words as you go, but you've got to be able to listen to them. Cohesive devices are fun also because students hear different things with them because they've been reduced. My favorite story is a student in one of my classes who was listening to me, And I began by saying, first of all, we are going to investigate blah, 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 blah. Well, first of all, to that student was kind of a, what is that? And he looks up the word festival. Festival. First of all, he couldn't get that sound proper. He didn't understand what that was. So reduced forms are very important, as well as cohesive devices. You can look at the macro elements as well. The language functions, okay, the purpose of this particular little monologue or dialogue. Inferring meaning. You hear something, but what does it actually mean? You hear something, and what are they saying that they're not really saying? You can be identifying the literal or the non-literal components in a language. Are they telling a joke, or are they being serious, right? That may also include things that you see, but you might hear it in hearing as well. And then some strategies that they might be employing as they're speaking, and the things they have to pick up as a user when they're listening. Let's take a look at some intensive, some of the micro things that you could be looking at. Minimal pairs. I love minimal pairs. It's a great way to focus on tiny sound segments that students can miss. So just for example, the difference between ear and year. Japanese students, which is where I did most of my overseas teaching, have a great problem with the Y sound. And so for them, they both sound the same. And so you can do things like a minimal pair type of activity where you can have them practice with those different sounds. Now, oftentimes what I do is I'll put a one here and I'll put a two here, right? And I'll tell the students, okay, I'm going to say one of these words. And you just put up a one or a two. So I'll say ear, and then I want them to put up a one. Or I'll say year, and I want them to put up a two. And I'll do this. I'll probably overemphasize the year so they can try to start distinguishing between them. And after I get most of the hands going ear and year, I'll de-emphasize the Y, year. And eventually I'll get people, oh, they can get it. Now they're all watching me. And after I'm doing this for a while, ear, year, ear, year, all of a sudden I put my hand over my mouth and I say ear and year. And now they can't see the differences. And now so they're trying to rely more on this. They're still doing one and two, and they love to do this, okay? But it's a great way for them to see the difference. Problem, of course, with this is that it's not in context. Now, fortunately, we're not dealing with the meaning of something. We're just trying to distinguish the sounds. But it's a great way to practice. You can also try to figure out the meaning or the situation. So, for example, you have this little, hey, can I have a menu? And the other guy says, oh, yeah, sure. That's all you hear. Okay, then you got to ask the question, okay, where is Tom? Where's the first guy? And so they need to figure out that context just based on the sounds that they heard. Another little thing that you can do to practice. Some other examples of minimal pairs. I believe I have some examples over here at this site. Caroline Bowen, a PhD. I just happened to find this online. I don't know who she is, other than that she's a speech language pathologist. She's got some wonderful minimal pairs here: soar, chore, slip, chip, cat, catch. Okay, these are at the beginning: slip, chip, some, chum. But these are at the end, right? Cat, catch. And you need to distinguish for your students, which ones do they need? I know for me, for example, I'm going to be doing the Y and the E sounds. I may be doing the S and the SH sounds for my students because they're not going to be able to hear that difference. But you can find these here, and you can play that little game, that little one-two game, just to get them to practice. Get them to notice. And really, that's what we're talking about, getting them to notice things. So minimal pairs, great little activity, and it's great for them to try to see that difference. I also, when I'm emphasizing on listening, if I'm talking about sounds, I want to emphasize the front sounds, sounds that you can see, like this, these, that, those. I'm going to talk to about my tongue being visible, this, that, these, those. Or people who pronounce an M on their teeth, my mother. And I will look at them and say, you look at my teeth, you look at my lips, you're going to see that they're together. So front things I can try to show them. Things that are in the middle of the mouth or sounds that are at the back of the mouth are harder to teach. Typically, I say L's and R's are harder to teach because they're not very visible. Those liquids, they glide, they move around. So they're going to be harder to teach. But I can deal with micro things. I can deal with little sounds. And you dealing with whatever culture, whatever language you're dealing with, and you're trying to teach them English, the further these sounds are away, if those sounds that they're having trouble with, they probably don't exist in their language. And so they're going to have difficulty with it. And that's just, it's just going to be the case. You can identify those sounds. You can work in minimal pairs to try to fix them. You can also have responsive listening, where they listen to something in some kind of form, or maybe it's an interview, and you've got questions and answers. So it's kind of back and forth responsive listening. It couldn't be a real word that they have to do. It could just be some type of a response. Game that I really love is TPR, if you know TPR. TPR means total physical response. And it's a great little game where students have to listen and do what you say. Okay? So if I say, touch the wall, well, then they go and they touch the wall. If I say, raise your hand, they raise their hands, kind of like Simon Says. But they're not producing anything. They're only listening. Okay? And obviously they need to comprehend as well. But they're listening. It's much more of a listening type of activity. Their whole body is responding, total physical response. But it's very much a listening type thing. Or you could also have it, recorded, where you have a little bit of a thing and then they need to respond. It's great for interviews when you're just going back and forth with short answers. Now, I say this is listening, but they have to answer. They have to respond somehow, whether it's with a nod or a hand up or, a head shaking or something. There is that back and forth that's going on. Multiple choice would be the same type of thing. Responsive listening. Another way to do this. Selective listening, where they're listening for specific information. I liken this to students who are taking a comprehension test. And normally when you have a comprehension test, you've got a segment that they have to read, and then a series of questions that go after. What do you tell your students to do? Read the questions first, so that you know what you're looking for. In selective listening, they have questions or circle, or they have to put everything in order. On a little graph or something, but they listen. As they're listening to whatever, they've got to put things in order. Or as they're listening, they've got to find the right answers. Close is a great activity that you can do with this, and we'll show you what a close is in just a minute. You can also do information transfers, which requires a little more speaking ability. But it's a great way to have students listen to greater bits of information and then answer the question or issue that their partner has, information transfer. Oftentimes it's used with pictures. You've got one group with a picture here and the other group with a different picture, and they got different bits of information. They got to try to find the missing pieces. Let's go take a look at some of these right now. Let's go take a look at a close, first of all. So for example, here is a song, 100 Years from Five for Fighting. I've taken the song and put all the words out here that are listed, as you can see, and I also have right here the audio. And so what I'll do is I'll start playing the audio for my students, and as they listen, they have to fill in the words. And this is a close. Close is where they're going to have every nth word that's going to be gone, and they need to fill it in. It's a great listening activity.
For a moment, caught in between 10 and 20, and I'm just dreaming, counting the ways to where you are. I'm swamped too for a moment.
So you see how that works. And so the students can practice with this, and they can listen to it over and over again. It's a nice close. It's audio. They're just trying to fill in the sounds that they hear. Obviously, the spelling has to be accurate, and so when they fill this in, they're going to try to submit and finish, and they can see what they got right or wrong. But it's a great listening activity. I will then take this and try to talk to them, try to discuss with them the meaning of the song, which is a different thing altogether now. But it's a great listening tool. So that's just one example. Here's another song. by Larry Norman, the late Larry Norman. It's just a great little way to take a song, block out a bunch of words, and allow them to practice listening. Object. You will see him in the air. He's an unidentified flying object, and you will drop your hands and stare. You will be afraid to tell your neighbors. So, they might... Again, that's just an example of how that can work with a closed type of activities. In addition, we also have the information gap. Let me give you an example of an information gap type of thing. Here you've got two sets, and I got this off of ESL Gold. Here you've got two sets of information, one that you give to one student, one that you give to another. And now they need to talk to each other. They need to communicate. They need to say, hey, fill this information. Who's the second person on your list? You know, you got to write that down. And they're asking each other questions. Okay, so obviously, this is more than just listening, but the other people have to listen as well. So that's a type of information gap. Here's another information gap that I got off of cramlap.org. And these are just some examples of an information gap. Notice that they've focused on, the grammatical elements that they're focusing on and how much time it's going to take. And there's some good explanation here. This is a very good example. You can see here's the first student's paper. They got all these things, and they've got this empty room, and they need to fill in the empty room with all the stuff. That's their paper. Now, the second student, he's got the room already filled in with the stuff. Okay, so here's for example, you go back up here, you see here's the picture, here's a computer, here's a TV, right? You see these pieces. But here they really are. Here's the picture. It's on the wall, above the bed, to the right of the door, right? And you can do stuff like that. There's the TV. Here's the computer. So you can talk back and forth, listening, trying to figure out where things go. And then the first student has to draw them or maybe cut them out and put them in places to where they belong. A great information gap act type of activity. And you can find more of these online in a variety of places. Or you can make your own, go out and purchase a book. So with selective listening, you're not trying to actually find the actual discrete sound. You're trying to hear those words and phrases, and obviously you need to understand what those are as well. Selective listening, that's more of the mid-range type of thing. You can also have extensive listening. You're listening to a longer block of language or communication. Maybe it's a discussion. You know, and so they have to pay attention and maybe take notes, or maybe it's a lecture, or maybe it's the close. Maybe it's a little longer. Some questions: how to distinguish listening performance? How to distinguish listening performance realm cognitive processing? Are these assessments really testing listening skills? And this is a real issue that I talked about earlier. I cannot actually assess the actual listening. Okay, the best way to do that would be at the minimal pairs thing that we're talking about. But at the higher level, I may hear it, but I don't know the vocabulary. I may hear it, but I don't know the grammar. I may hear it and I know the vocabulary, but the person who's speaking, I don't know their accent. So the variety of problems as you get to the higher level listening, but you can still have them practice listening at longer levels, looking for those key words, those cohesive devices, those special phrases that someone might be using over and over again. things that you can do at the longer end. You can do dictation. I don't know about you, but when I was in school learning Spanish, dictations were never fun, and I didn't really enjoy them, but research indicates that they're an excellent way to assess and improve listening. What are you doing again? You're trying to spell out the sounds that you hear, whether you know what they are or not. So dictation is going to be an excellent way to do this. Another activity that I actually don't have listed here is something called shadowing. And shadowing is an opportunity for the students to repeat everything the teacher says. And so you've got the teacher talking, and then behind the teacher you've got the student saying the same thing. Okay, today class. And it's all through class. I happened to sit into this research project that these men were doing, presenting at a conference, and it was amazing to know that these kids were constantly talking throughout the entire class, shadowing. And they left tired, emotionally tired, because they were doing so much. They had to listen in order to produce. Again, they don't even need to understand what they're saying. They just need to be able to reproduce the sound. Shadowing. So, but that would be a more of an extensive thing as well. You could also do extended audio with questions. Note-taking. One of my most favorite classes that I taught while I lived overseas was in the Waseda University. And I taught a group of science students listening. And they had to listen to a 20-minute lecture. Now, I practiced with them and tried to help them understand what the segments were. You know, we broke things down in blocks. But eventually, they had to listen to 20 minutes of this lecture and had to take notes. It was a note-taking class. It was a wonderful class. It was an opportunity to obviously focus on vocabulary that they didn't know, sounds that they may have difficulty with, specialized scientific terminology, more of the specialized grammar that might be used in that particular field of study. It was a wonderful way to do this. It was a note-taking class, but it was extended. It was a lecture. You can also work on critical thinking. Why is this way? Loved working with commercials to do that kind of thing. You can also do editing. Students are going to receive a document, and they hear the audio related to the document, but there are problems in the document. They now need to go edit it, okay, so that it aligns with the audio. Just some things that you can do extended-wise, right? Let's go take a look at some extended listening. This is a little lecture on nanotechnology. It's 22 minutes long. Well, that would be great. And I can start this and let it play.
Imagine a tiny robot the size of a human cell.
This is in
injected
YouTube.
Injected by the millions into your bloodstream to embark on a search and destroy mission to locate.
Now, you'll notice as the person's talking here, he's speaking in a not an American accent. He's speaking with a different accent. But this student now can listen to this lecture over and over again. It'd be great practice to have something like this. It's a lecture, and they can listen to it. The other nice thing,
cancer cells and kill them,
is that they will be able to click on this button right here and turn on
eradicating the nasty side effects of chemo and radiotherapy.
Their closed caption.
Now imagine
that's going to allow them to actually listen to the audio and read at the same time.
Almost invisible to the naked eye, and fabrics that can never wrinkle or stain.
Okay, and I know we don't need to go into the example here, but this is just another. They can do a 20-minute lecture here. I would, as a teacher, I'd have to go in and probably listen to it first, maybe develop some questions or understand, you know, what this is, so that when they make an outline or a paper based off of it, if I give them a test off of it, it's an excellent opportunity. This is again at the upper end of listening practice. You begin with the small and you go to the larger. So we've talked about a variety of ways to assess listening at the micro and at the macro level, and also some of the reasons why it's important. I do thank you for stopping by. If you have any questions, you can certainly give me a holler. Have a nice day. Talk to you later.